to the 26th, 1988, I was a participant in the March of the Living. The march, arranged by the Commission on Jewish Education, gathered 1,500 Jewish youth from all over the world to visit concentration camps in Poland for Yom HaShoah, Holocaust Remembrance Week, and to travel to Israel to celebrate Yom HaSamu'ut, Israel Independence Day. In Poland, the actual march took place. Walking in silence, the 1,500 students marched the 2 miles from the Auschwitz concentration camp to the Birkenau death camp. They followed the same route the prisoners marched 45 years ago. The only difference was the students were marching as survivors of the Holocaust. The prisoners were marching to their deaths. We also experienced the concentration camps at Auschwitz, Birkenau, Treblinka, and Majdanek. In the Warsaw Ghetto, we participated in the memorial services commemorating the 45th anniversary of the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising. I went to the concentration camps to try to understand the pain, agony, and torture the Jewish people endured during the Holocaust. I returned dedicated to communicate the story of the Holocaust to my generation. Through my photography essay on the Holocaust, I hope to bring you as close as possible to seeing under what conditions the people lived. But there is one aspect of the Holocaust I am unable to communicate to you through my photographs. I cannot show you the multitudes of people who suffered. You must use your imaginations to envision their suffering. I ask you to please dedicate yourselves to making sure it will never happen again. This camp is the first camp that we went to, and it's called Auschwitz. And the reason I took this picture was to basically capture the mood of the camp. And that day it was pouring, and it was just gray and yucky. And what I wrote about the Auschwitz camp was, today the barracks as well as the surrounding grounds are so clean and orderly that it is not possible to imagine the agony and horrors the people endured there. The next picture I took was a picture of Birkenau. And during our march, we had to march into Birkenau. And these train tracks lead right directly in the center of Birkenau. And they used to deport the prisoners on these train tracks. And leaving Birkenau, I walked those train tracks. This picture is called Railroad Leading to Birkenau. The trains brought people from towns, cities, and countries across Europe to concentration camps. Even when the Nazis were losing the war and trains were needed to transport soldiers, the trains of death continued on an efficient schedule. This is a cattle car that the prisoners were being transported on. Sometimes they'd be locked in there for 3 or more days. Their bodies would be squished so tightly together that they couldn't even move. They had no sanitation and they had no food. It's called cattle car. Hundreds of people at a time were deported via cattle cars to the concentration camps. For 3 days or more, they were packed tightly into cattle cars with no food or sanitation. Scratch marks of desperation can be found in the inside walls of the cars. This is the gate leading into Birkenau. I took this picture for the reason that you can just imagine the torture that the people endured behind these gates. Inside Jews, Poles, Russians, Yugoslavians, Czechoslovakians, Greeks, Bulgarians, Austrians, French, Germans, and Belgians were tortured and massacred. The bunks in Majdanek, in these bunks, 5 or more prisoners would lie width-wise at a time. You could just imagine the people lying there with just flesh and bones. They only wore their clothes that they entered the concentration camps with. And some nights they didn't have pillows. Sometimes they'd have blankets, but that was once in a while. It was very scarce. Many prisoners slept together in one bed. They slept in the clothes which they wore. Lublin, town in the distance. This picture shows Lublin, which is 1 mile away from the Majdanek concentration camp. And the reason I took this picture was because I couldn't understand how the people believed the Nazis when they were told, when the Nazis told the citizens that it was only a prisoner camp. And I couldn't understand how the people couldn't smell the burning flesh and the screams and the cries from the prisoners when they were being massacred. These are a sample of the shoes that were in the Majdanek concentration camp. The Nazis confiscated baby shoes and adult shoes from the prisoners. There were enough to fill an auditorium. It was just amazing and incredible. Adult and baby shoes are a small portion of the tens of thousands of shoes which were confiscated from the prisoners after they were murdered by the Nazis. This is a suitcase in Auschwitz. Each person entering in Auschwitz was allowed only one suitcase to fill with their belongings. On the suitcase is the name Fuchs, the family name of the leader on the trip. Upon seeing this, my leader could just imagine herself. She had no survivor. She didn't have any people, any relatives who were killed in the Holocaust. She could just imagine herself being one of those people shipped away to the concentration camps to be killed. Snowy in Birkenau. In the winter, prisoners worked in one-layer garments, and many froze. This is the Birkenau concentration camp, and I just wanted you to see that in rain or shine, the prisoners only had one pair of clothes, and that's what they wore, and some froze to death. Showers in Medenik. These showers were the showers of the prisoners. Every prisoner had it, and were told by the Nazis that they had to strip, take off their clothes, and leave them outside the showers, and they were to go and take showers. In the showers, a selection was made, meaning that to the left, the prisoners who the strong prisoners who were chosen for slave labor would go out the left door, and the right door, the weak prisoners who were chosen to be killed would exit. From the showers into the gas chambers, the weak ones would. And this is a gas chamber. Hundreds of people were piled into these gas chambers and just gassed. Under such horrifying circumstances, people climbed on top of each other to try to get air. Mothers pressed their babies against their chests to protect them from breathing the gas. Bodies from the gas chambers were then, the corpses were sent to the crematoriums to be burned. After the prisoners were killed in the gas chambers, their bodies were brought to the crematoriums by trucks. There they would burn the bodies until nothing was left but ashes. Towards the end of the war, when the Nazis were not able to kill the Jews or the prisoners fast enough, they had mass graves, and this is a mass grave in Medenik. And what they would do was line people up on the edge of this mass grave and shoot them, and their bodies would fall in, hundreds of bodies would fall into these mass pits, and they would then be buried. This is a cemetery in Treblinka, and at Treblinka, this is a concentration camp that the Nazis destroyed everything. They didn't want any remains left in this concentration camp because they didn't want anyone to believe or to know that these murders were taking place. As you look at this picture, you would think that each cemetery stone signified one person who died during the Holocaust, but in fact it signifies a community of people who were killed in the Holocaust. This is a collapsed building in Birkenau, and in Birkenau, the Germans did destroy some of the buildings, and there were remnants, unlike Treblinka, there was remnants that was left over. Besides this harsh building, there were also crematoriums that stood, but the only part of the crematoriums that stood were the chimneys. This is entitled The March of the Living. When we were, the 1,500 Jewish students from around the world were in Poland, we gathered for a 2-mile walk from the Auschwitz slave labor camp to the Birkenau death camp. And upon this walk, we marched the same path that the prisoners did 45 years ago, except we were marching as survivors of the Holocaust and they were marching to their deaths. As you can see, it says in the picture, an Arbeit macht frei. And the Nazis taught the prisoners at Auschwitz that if they were to work hard, then they would be free. But in fact, the harder they worked, the weaker they became. And then they were marched to Birkenau to be killed. You have to understand, though, that Auschwitz does have crematoriums, but Birkenau was 4 times as big as Auschwitz. And at Auschwitz, it was mostly a representational camp in which the leaders of the Nazi Party would come visit to see what was really going on. And they would say, oh, it's not that bad. This picture is entitled Remembering, and at a Hungarian Jewish cemetery, this girl was remembering the 600,000 Jewish Hungarian people who were killed during the Holocaust. This is entitled Sites Without Sounds, Belongings Without People, A View of the Holocaust Today by Alicia Wichman. The Holocaust was the murder of 11 million people by the Nazis during World War II. Of the 11 million people, 6 million were Jews. Of the 6 million people, 2 million were children. This photography exhibit depicts the scenes of the remains from the concentration camps in Poland. The concentration camps or where the people were transported to be used as slave laborers. Fed the meagerest of nutrition, the people withered to skin and bones. When they became too weak to continue working, they were marched into the showers, then to the gas chambers, and into the crematorium. The victims are gone, their voices silenced. The photographs just thus show us the sights without the sound. The Nazis also took all the belongings of their victims and anything on the person that might be reused. Hair, gold, teeth, shoes, clothing. The photographs thus show us the belongings without the people. Thanks to sponsors, this trip and exhibit was made possible. Chase Foundation, Commission on Jewish Education, Temple Beth Shalom, and especially Mr. Kaling, my photography advisor.